Use the force, Luke.
Live long and prosper.
I was going to Tosche Station to pick up some power converters.
Lilu Dallas Multipass.
Shut up and take my money.
By Grabthar's hammer. What a saving.
One does not simply walk into Mordor.
X never, ever marks the spot.
Winter is coming.
You're a wizard, Harry.
Stay a while and listen.
My whole Kermit the Frog.
Your ties are cool.
So say we all.
This is a Play on Nerds.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to episode 50 of A Play on Nerds. Episode 50. I am your co-host, Steve. I'm not Steve.
I'm Steve. You're Jarman.
We've done so many of these episodes, I don't even know who I am anymore.
You think we would have gotten it straight by now, but no.
Nope.
It's going to be at least another 50 episodes before we get it right.
I think so. Yeah, that's Steve, and I'm Jarman. So welcome to our 50th episode, a milestone.
Wow. 50?
Yeah.
How the hell did we do that?
I mean, we did have a big year episode. We had our year anniversary episode, but this is our 50th anniversary episode. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And we're going to be covering a lot of these later on about everything having to do with the number 50, like actors who are turning 50, things that are 50th anniversary this year, because a lot of things are. So it's a big time. 1965, I guess, was 50.
It was a hell of a year. Yeah. A hell of a year, apparently. A lot of stuff went down.
So it's we're keeping a good schedule here. So we're back after 2 weeks, like we should be. So what have you been up to these past couple of weeks, Steve?
I have, just sort of counting down the days at work until as of today is my first official day on my first Thanksgiving break.
Oh, okay. How long is that going to be again?
I get this weekend. We get Thursday and Friday off just as national holiday stuff. But they gave us Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday off also. So I have all this week and next weekend.
That's awesome. And where are you going to go somewhere?
Yes. So in a previous episode, I mentioned that our van is making some clunky noises. I did had a little bit of maintenance done. It's a little bit better, but I don't want to chance it on an 8.5 hour drive to Las Vegas. So I actually, the errand I just went out and ran is I went and picked up a rental car.
Nice.
A Nissan Versa.
Nice.
I know, it's luxury. And that's what we will be driving, because though I love the van, I don't trust it and I don't want it to ruin our vacation.
I used to own a Nissan Versa.
Wow. Very nice.
For a girlfriend that I was dating. And then I sold it to her.
Aw. And then she left you for a clown, huh?
Probably. She joined the circus.
Every damn time.
Every time. What's with the circus? Stealing my girlfriends.
I don't know. This is carnies. They must be small hands, but they're good with them, I guess.
Smell like cabbage.
Yeah. Women love cabbage.
So what are you going to do in Las Vegas?
So everyone has been asking, are you going to gamble? And yes, we're going to gamble, but Ann and I have set very realistic and strict limits on how much we're going to gamble. We each have $50.
Okay.
To go and gamble. If we win, great. If not, it's $50 and it's something to go experience. I think of it as an activity to be enjoyed in Las Vegas, just like I would go on a tour. Like, it's not something I want to do the whole time I'm there.
Yeah, it's like you're paying $50 for the fun games and stuff, and if you win, right. Great. Why not?
And if you're at the big casinos, they give you free drinks while you're playing slots.
So that's worth it.
Right. $50 worth of drinks.
Exactly. Which isn't that much in Las Vegas usually.
No. Plus, I always keep telling, and I know this is how Las Vegas gets people. I'm going to sound like every dumb yup in America right now. But some people win in Las Vegas.
Yeah.
Some people play that slot machine and walk away with like a random $12,000 jackpot.
So who knows?
That happens. It happens to somebody. If everybody had it happen to them, Vegas would be out of business.
And if they never did it, then no one would come.
Right. So if somebody must win, and why not me with the $50 we're going to take?
Absolutely. And if you win $12,000, I want at least $300 of that to pay for a ticket for me to come visit you.
Deal. And I'll buy a bunch of like Play on Nerds t-shirts so we can give out as prizes.
There you go. Perfect.
There we go. If I win a jackpot, that's the deal.
Keeping you to it.
I agree.
It's on the record.
Anna will keep me honest.
Very cool.
What about you? What have you been up to?
Nothing quite as exciting as Las Vegas coming up for me. But this past week, my stepbrother and his wife and his little son, Clark, named Mr. Clark Kent, are visiting in town here. And it's adorable because Clark loves Star Wars. He's obsessed with it. And he wakes up in the morning and sings da 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 da. And then so he points the TV and says, "Dart, Dart." So he wants them to play the video of Darth Vader because he's obsessed with Darth Vader. I don't know why.
He likes the villain.
Yeah, and the Imperial March. I mean, this guy's going to be on the dark side.
Yeah.
And finally, they couldn't get him to say my name, but they got him to call me Jar Jar. So that's what he calls me.
Jar Jar.
Yep.
That's an adorable nephew uncle name.
It is.
That's adorable.
Even though it's a hated character, I don't mind being Jar Jar.
How old is Clark now?
He's 18 months.
Wow. So right when shit gets really crazy.
Yeah, he's just barely talking, so... It's pretty cool.
He's up and mobile. He's talking. He's becoming a little person.
Exactly.
Soon he's going to realize that he can manipulate people and it's all downhill.
Also, I went to the Madame Tussauds Wax Museum today.
Ooh.
I didn't know there was one in Orlando, but apparently there is now. And took some funny pictures that were kind of nerdy. So I'll post them on to Play on Nerds later when I get them.
I'm excited to see them.
Yeah. Including one that will be a surprise for Steve. So I need to get him back after many years ago. He pulled a prank on me. I wonder if you'll know what it is.
Oh, I know exactly what you're talking about. Exactly.
So a long time
ago.
Do
we want to reveal this? Okay.
Yeah, go ahead. You tell it.
So I was in New York for, I believe, my 16th birthday, maybe my 18th, with my brother. And we were walking through Times Square. I'm not quite sure why, because my brother avoids Times Square like the plague. And outside of the Madame Tussauds, or maybe Ripley's Believe It or Not, something, one of the major ones there. There was a wax statue of Samuel L. Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
And I walked up and Christian snapped a picture of me with it. And the way he was standing, he wasn't facing the camera. So it looked a little bit more lifelike, a little bit more real. And there were two Asian tourists standing and taking a picture with him. And it looked like he was actively taking a picture with them because of the way he was looking. So for years, I maintained that I met Samuel L. just walking through New York. And snapped a picture with him and lived this lie for God. It was so good.
And I think I finally found out through your brother that it was not really him.
Yeah. Originally the picture was posted on my website that I had way back in the day, Saltwater Coffee.
Yeah.
That was a very short chapter. And if you highlighted the photo in the bottom right, Christian had a little invisible text that if you highlighted it, said like, not actually Samuel L. Jackson.
That's hilarious. So
you
I
had
get
to highlight the photo to see it.
And it's the same exact statue.
What?
Same position, same outfit.
Oh, I'm so excited now.
And I stopped Peter
so
Beer. We have to take a picture of this. So he took a picture of me in front of it. I thought that was too funny. And that was like 15 years ago you took that picture.
Yeah, it must have been.
Ridiculous. So anyways.
Wow, I'm very excited to see Samuel again.
Like he's looking off to the right. He has his hands on his hips. Like it's the same damn thing.
Shit. Oh, that's exciting. I'm glad that still exists somewhere.
Yep. And the only other thing I mentioned this week, Jessica Jones, the series came out for Marvel on Netflix.
Oh, okay.
And I watched the first couple episodes. It's really good, really dark, really adult. So it's fun. It's worth watching. So check it out, people. Not that you won't
Jessica
already.
Jones.
Because you watched, did you watch Daredevil?
I didn't.
Oh, okay. You'd probably like that too.
I'm a fool.
You are a fool. How dare you?
Legit. I'm rewatching through Game of Thrones right now. So once I get through that, I'll have options.
That's worth rewatching, of course.
Okay.
To catch all the small things.
Yeah. I'm rewatching the most recent season right now. So it's the one I've seen the least. Gotcha. So it's the most exciting.
So do you have any nerdy news for us this week?
I do. I do have nerdy news.
It's time for Nerdy News.
So, in honor of the 50th episode, I have to do what I've done for most of my nerd news and have a cheeky name. And this nerd news is no different. It is called For Gourd's Sake.
Oh, God.
So I read a story about some researchers who have realized that humans both almost destroyed gourds as we know it. And I mean pumpkins and like squashes and those sort of things.
Yeah.
Almost completely eliminated them, but then brought them back and made them what they are today. And so they did a study of gourds and way back in like, I think the Lysine era, the gourds would have been smaller and much more bitter. To small animals, they would have been toxic and would have killed them. So the only animals that could have handled them were big, huge mammals, essentially. So giant sloths and like mastodons and woolly mammoths, those sort of things. So the mastodons would trample and poop out these gourds and spread their seed. So it was mutually beneficial.
Mm-hmm.
But then man showed up, drove all of the large mammals out, and gourds were almost done for because they had lost their symbiotic relationship that allowed them to reproduce. But then man found gourds and we started domesticating them. The earliest use for gourds was not eating, because back then they said they were much more bitter, but actually it was made the first bowls and water carriers.
Like they're so hard.
Yeah. And then through domestication, we later made them edible. And that is how we have the pumpkins and the squashes and all that we have today.
I see.
Because we almost completely killed them out, and then we decided we like them. And now they're here with us still.
So it really was perfect timing, because we didn't have domesticated plants. We wouldn't have been able to figure it out.
That's true.
Interesting.
Yeah. So I just thought that's a cool life finds a way.
The history of evolution has taught us that life will not be contained. Life breaks free. It expands to new territories and it crashes through barriers painfully, maybe even dangerously. But I'm simply saying that life finds a way.
We would have had pumpkins.
Yeah, we'd Halloween. Be carving like carrots or something awful.
Not quite as cool.
Maybe watermelons? I'm trying to think of like another large hollow thing
I could work, you could
carve a face into. Watermelon. Maybe like a big red bell pepper.
Potatoes. I don't know.
Potatoes.
That's an Irish Halloween.
So yeah, for Gord's sake.
Adorable. I had a couple little snippets for some nerdy news. First, I found fascinating was recently George Lucas made some remarks about Star Wars and kind of why he left. And he did some interviews when he did one with Vanity Fair magazine. And one of the reasons why he didn't make more movies is that he said, you go to make a movie and all you do is get criticized and people try to make decisions about what you're going to do before you do it. It's not much fun and you can't experiment. You can't do anything because you have to do it a certain way. I started out in experimental films and I want to go back to experimental films. I'll be directing movies, but they won't be movies that will be generally shown anywhere. and he also said, the issue is ultimately they looked at the stories and they said, we want to make something for the fans. People don't actually realize it's actually a soap opera and it's all about family problems. It's not about spaceships. So they decided they didn't want to use those stories. They decided that they were going to do their own thing. So I decided, fine, I'll go my own way and let them go their way. So that was kind of his opinion.
Okay.
Any feeling on that?
I mean, I don't know. He is the creator. He does have some level of ownership, so I can understand it from that point of view.
Yeah.
But you don't, when you create something as iconic as Star Wars, you can't always win.
It becomes bigger than you, basically.
Yeah, you know, Star Trek falls in that same category. Like, yeah, the original creators of Star Trek maybe had a vision. I can guarantee these new movies don't meet that original vision, but it got bigger than them.
Yep. And you kind of just let it go. Let it become its own thing and be a billionaire in peace.
Yeah, just rest.
That's what he's doing now. That's what the hell he wants.
Oh, my God. All the merchandising rights that he retained? Holy shit.
Yep.
That man. And I think he's like the second or third richest man in Hollywood.
Probably. And he's a great guy, too. Apparently, he has a giant amount of property where he lives that he wants to rent out or basically build low-income housing on his property and give it to next to nothing for homeless people that are in the area. And all the rich houses and properties that are around that area are refusing to let him do it. They're like, we don't want homeless people living near us. So,
yeah, the funny tidbit along with that story is originally on that land, he wanted to build his own high-tech sound studio.
Oh.
And all of his rich neighbors filed injunctions saying he couldn't do it because of sound and noise and, you know, the production people and the crews that would be out there and that it would be disruptive to the community. So he said, fine. And he donated the land to that low-income housing group.
It's like they just will not let him get away with anything, it seems like.
Fine. That's great. Rich neighbors. Enjoy your new neighbors.
Who will not be rich.
No.
And also a piece of news that's pretty cool. NASA has officially made a contract with SpaceX, the company owned by Elon Musk of Tesla Motors and such. They're going to use them exclusively to send astronauts to the space station, which is pretty cool.
Very neat.
I think that's the way of the future, is that we're going to be using all corporations to do our space work and just kind
of. We'll contract out.
Yeah, yeah. Like partner with the government, basically. It's the way of the future.
Yep.
We'll get a flight on Virgin Galactic up to the space empire. Also, I just heard recently that somebody is going. There are currently people in law school to get their degree in space law.
It makes sense. I mean, it's going to be a whole new. It'll be like maritime law. It'll be its own thing.
Yeah, because basically they'll have, you know, space casinos. You'll have people mining asteroids and all the money that's involved. You'll need people who specialize in that kind of law. So that's a thing now. There's space lawyers. I want to be a space prostitute.
Yeah.
The first one.
Space prostitute launched into space, cryogenically frozen, woken up for tricks, and then put back to sleep.
That's right. From a previous episode. Call back. Yeah.
So here's a quick nerdy news story. Maybe not even nerdy, but just amuse me. At Fifth Avenue Apple, where I once worked, a man yelling, "All I want is an iPhone," brought a samurai sword and started swinging it around as he entered the store.
Oh, boy.
And he had to be tackled outside, and there's video of it from down in the store, and there's just a line of employees like that just have no idea what to do.
This was recently?
This was like yesterday or the day before.
Oh, God.
But the real thing that concerns me about the video is that the employees have no idea what to do.
Yeah, because what do you do? I don't know.
You evacuate.
Hmm.
I know that store. There are evacuation routes beside the main one because there have to be. I mean, that seems like it would make sense to me. But everyone's sort of standing around not knowing what to do. And that makes me more nervous than anyone.
Yeah, I think, like, unfortunately, with the way our climate is and our society with all the attacks everywhere and just random stuff, we need to have more education about what to do in those situations, because apparently they're happening all the time. So,
and honestly, and this is going to make me sound a little bit paranoid, but I think a place like Fifth Avenue Apple would be the kind of target.
True. It's a big place.
Something like that.
Really populated.
Big American company that has done very well and is very successful right in the middle of a major city.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, So hopefully this gets them to reevaluate what the hell they're doing as far as when emergencies come up.
That's really unfortunate. I'm glad you weren't there for that, though.
Oh, thank the Lord.
And that brings us to our big 50th anniversary episode special. Anniversary. Judicial system. So we're going to talk about everything 50 related. So first off, I think we're just going to chat about all the actors and actresses and famous people who are becoming 50 this year, 2015.
Yeah, there's some big ones and some sort of surprising ones. So the first one, everyone's favorite horse, Sarah Jessica Parker.
Oh, God. Yeah.
Well, everyone's heard of horse since Mr. Ed. Sorry, sir.
Robert Downey Jr. turning 50.
Yep. One that really surprised me because I imagined him as older than 50. Charlie Sheen.
God, because he's lived a rough life.
Yeah. Every time I see him, I'm like, man, he's got to be like 65 now, right?
And the news just came out that he's HIV positive, and he has been for some time now.
Man,
he was paying people off to keep it a secret for a long time. And he said he can finally stop paying them because he's just going to be public about it. So he lived a rough life so far.
Yeah, he has. Moby.
That's right. Moby.
A guy who used to hang out with Gwen Stefani.
And speaking of Gwen Stefani, Gavin Rossdale, her husband long. He's 50 this year as well.
So I think the sexiest 50-year-old on this list.
Mm-hmm.
Diane Lane.
Really?
Damn, Diane Lane.
I don't know. I think she has competition on the 50 list here. Elizabeth Hurley is 50.
I just don't like, she's sort of ruined herself for me.
She has gotten all too much of the plastic surgery going crazy with that.
Another one I would consider that is also on this list, Brooke Shields.
I've always loved Brooke Shields. I love the eyebrows.
What her episode of hosting The Muppet Show is one of my favorites. She was like 15 at the time. It's great.
If we're going with hotties still, another one I have to mention is Michelle Forbes, who is a favorite of mine from Star Trek and Battlestar Galactica. She played Ensign Ro on Star Trek, and she was in the Razor series. She was the female admiral in Battlestar.
Let me see. Looking her up. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, she's a hottie for her age and period. She's a hottie.
Yeah, she was in the second or third season of True Blood. Super
That's hot. Right. She was great in that, too. On the opposite spectrum, ugly men, Rob Zombie is 50.
Good.
Vinnie Jones as well.
Also ugly men, John C. Reilly.
Yes.
And that's someone hilarious. Who I don't think anybody anticipated making it to 50, Mr. Andy Dick.
Oh, yeah.
Turned 50
he's
this
still
year.
Alive.
And with all the drugs and craziness he went through, what, 10 years ago, 15 years ago now, I'm surprised he's still with us.
On that same note of drugs and craziness, Carrot Top is now 50 years old,
yep.
Which is scary.
So, Jarman and I grew up in Winter Park, Florida, and Carrot Top lived there or had a house there or spent a lot of time there. I don't know which. But on multiple occasions, you would get to see him riding in downtown Winter Park on his moped, shirtless, so just white, terrible, awful, reflective skin, and then a big bush of red hair.
Yep.
And you would, and he just shirtless driving his moped around downtown Winter Park.
Like, he's so weird looking.
And even more so now. I remember him in Winter Park when he was still skinny little Carrot Top. Now he's like, oh, fucking Carrot Top.
It's huge.
Beefcake.
It's terrifying.
And now two actual good people that were glad are made it to 50. Chris Rock.
Absolutely.
50 this year. And Ben Stiller.
Absolutely. He's doing the Zoolander, which we're reviewing later in this episode. Yeah. With some other comedic actors that are turning 50, John Cryer and Kevin James.
Okay, that's right. Paul Blart.
Also, Jeremy Piven, who I used to love in that movie PCU from so long ago.
Oh, that's on, it's on HBO. Man, and I just watched it. So
love that movie. Also, William Zabka. Do you know that name?
No.
He is the villain from Karate Kid. The bully.
Really? He died?
No, he's 50.
Oh, he's 50. That makes more sense.
He's not dead.
I was just thinking about Charlie Sheen. How he should be gone by now. I know, but he should be gone by now.
But we also, there's Viola Davis, who's going to be in the new Suicide Squad movie. Michael Bay, who we all love so much.
I love explosions.
Yes.
And watching them in slow motion.
Alan Cumming, our favorite cabaret and nightcrawler. And Bjork.
Ugh.
Who I remember from Space Ghost Coast to Coast as a little kid. Being on, that's where I knew her from.
I mean, I always will know her by that iconic swan dress that was mocked and made reference to on everything from Family Guy to Saturday Night Live. Dear Lord.
I have a few more little sci-fi things here. From Babylon 5, Claudia Christian is 50. Alexander Siddig, who is Dr. Bashir on Deep Space Nine, is 50. Amanda Tapping from Stargate. Is 50.
Wow, a lot of star.
Yeah, star. And then J.K. Rowling, 50 years old. She looks great for 50.
She has enough time to pump out like another 6 Harry Potter books, right?
Oh, yeah.
George R.R. Martin's still going. She's got time.
She's much healthier than he is, too.
Yes.
And last two I'll mention are Walking Dead stars. Lenny James, who plays Morgan on The Walking Dead.
Okay.
And Melissa McBride, who plays Carol on The Walking Dead. She is also 50, so...
Lenny James, I love from, have you ever seen Jericho?
I haven't, but I've heard a lot of good things.
It was a short-lived, for those who don't know about Jericho, because it didn't really have any success, it was a short-lived series about a small town, I think in Jericho, Kansas, after a major nuclear attack on the U.S. And Lenny James plays a agent who was sent there because that town had one of the highest probabilities of survival. And he knows more than everyone thinks he does. And it's just great. Overall great.
He always plays Americans, but he's British.
And there's only 1.5 seasons. Yeah. So check it out.
I think it's on Netflix or it was for a while, but
it was
gone now.
Yeah.
All right. And that's it for at least the actors. I'm sure there's many more, but that's the ones that we've stuck out to us. So,
yeah. So let's talk about 50 years ago. What was going
Absolutely.
On? I guess 50th anniversary of or 50 years ago, whatever. In 1965, Malcolm X was assassinated.
That's true.
We put our first combat troops into Vietnam.
The March on Selma, which is related, was also 1965, 50 years ago.
like the four marches on Selma it took to actually do it.
Yeah.
Sonny and Cher, I Got You, Babe, hit the airwaves.
We apologize. Babe,
I got you, Bear.
Put your little hand in mine.
Do mm-hmm. you believe in
I like you went to that immediately. two movies that were great, My Fair Lady and Mary Poppins, both with came out, same actress.
And they both won a ton of Oscars.
Yes. Good movies. Lyndon Johnson was sworn in for his first full term. Also, the 50th anniversary of this year of the first spacewalk in U.S. history. I think the Russians beat us to it, but it's the first U.S. one.
Yeah, that was the Gemini, right?
Something like that. Yeah.
The Beatles, the movie Help, premiered in 1965.
Help, I need somebody.
Help.
Help. Sung by Creed. Or 55-year-old Cher.
And big one for the nerd community, I guess, Tom and Jerry premiered.
Really?
One of the first earlier cartoons.
Huh. I would have thought that was in the 50s.
Yeah, but the 60s were when TVs were finally common in households, though.
I know, that's true. I just thought it was like a movie serial before that.
50s was like early adopters. Who knows? It might have been. They might have been little snippets before films.
And it's not quite this year, but next year will be the 50th anniversary of Star Trek. So that's coming.
Yeah.
I'm sure they were thinking about it in 1965.
That means in like another 25 episodes, we can do that episode.
Right? Exactly.
Something like that.
I like it. So once again, I'm sure there was more stuff, but
that's the important stuff. Don't learn anything else about 1965, except for what we just told you.
That's all that's important.
Actually, learn more because we're terrible.
We're horrible human beings. And we apologize, Raul Julia.
As always. All right, ladies and gentlemen. So now it's time to bring back a inappropriately named game. 50 State Factoid Fumble. So I will tell you before I disappoint you that the original premise of this game is that we were going to go through all 50 states and Jarman was going to have to tell me a fact about all 50 states. And then we realized that was stupid and would take for friggin' ever. So I'm going to call this 50 State Factoid Fumble, but actually it's 10. I'm sorry. I lied.
And this is a game we've done before the podcast where basically it's word association. Either Steve says a word to me and I have to basically think of the first thing that comes to my mind or that I think is a fact about it, or I make up a fact.
Yeah, so in this case, Jarman is going to educate you on 10 states I've chosen.
Am I ever?
Are you?
We'll see.
All right. Are you ready?
Yep.
Tell me one thing you know about Georgia.
Well, one thing about Georgia is that the place where my family is all from in southern Georgia near Brunswick, they're actually building a launch pad there. So it'll be a huge pad for SpaceX and other companies. It's this middle of nowhere town. And Steve actually has been to that house before.
I have.
So that whole town is going to be built up like crazy because now they're making a joint task force in this middle of nowhere part of Georgia to launch rockets, which is crazy. So that's very happened, cool. Folks.
All right. Good actual fact.
Yeah, that wasn't a funny one. It was just a fact.
Rhode Island.
Rhode Island's neither a road nor an island. Discuss.
Correct.
Correct.
Michigan.
I hear Detroit's really nice this time of year.
Correct. I also would have accepted it looks like a mitten.
yes. Yeah, it's okay. Gross with lakes.
A state no one knows anything about, Wyoming.
The state motto for Wyoming. Wyoming, why are you here?
Accurate. New York.
The greatest city you'll never want to live in.
Accurate. Texas.
Many times this podcast, we apologize to Raul Julia and his family. I want to apologize to the rest of the world for the state of Texas.
Yes, we're all. We all regret it. Though they do make some good food. So.
They make some good food. They got a lot of U.S. history there, but unfortunately, most of Texas is stuck in that history.
Yes, that's accurate.
Austin's great, though.
All right. Keep Austin weird.
Yeah.
All right. California.
The home of the wonderful and notorious Steve Bauman, the co-host of this podcast.
That is accurate, though I am not notorious. I'm under the radar. Florida.
Oh, if I apologize for Texas, maybe I spoke too soon. Florida, home of Florida Man, who you'll find doing every disgusting thing you can possibly imagine, every heinous crime you can think of, and a man you don't want to have around your children.
And if I remember correctly, it is still the U.S. capital for vehicular hit rate and vehicular hit death rate.
Yes.
So.
But come to Orlando and view our wonderful theme parks and attractions.
Please come. We have a dancing rat. Is that what you want?
Florida, America's penis.
We'll add more strip clubs. Is that it?
Add more crimes and, you know, decapitations.
Yep.
It's wonderful.
All right. Last one. Washington.
Washington, home of Bigfoot and hipsters.
Yes, that's correct.
Because I love Washington for its home of Bigfoot. Steve actually lived there for many years.
All right. That was actually 9. So I lied to you again. I'm sorry.
You're a bad human being.
I am. That's accurate. Good facts. And I hope you all learned something out there.
Indeed. There's a lot to learn.
Yeah. We pack a lot of content in these episodes.
Speaking of that, we just want to take a second to look back and think about what has this podcast meant to us in 50 episodes.
50 episodes.
I mean, I want you people to tell us what it's meant for you. Please write in and tell us what this podcast is good for, if anything. Or if you just listen to it while you, you know, feed your dog or something. I don't
know.
We'll
take that as good for.
Yes.
I'm with Jarman. I don't know how we were talking about this right before we started recording. I don't know how we got here. 50 episodes?
Yeah, over a year of podcasting?
Yeah, we've done like 13 copycat cinemas. We've had like, I think, 12 guests now in total.
Yeah. Even more.
Yeah, it's just we've come a long way. I remember that first episode when neither of us really knew what we were doing. And we had like a very rough estimate of what was happening. And we thought copycat cinema was a really good idea.
And it is. It is.
But we were going to really hinge on that for a while.
Yeah, we kind of did.
We did. The first like 6 or 7 episodes. I'm glad we didn't do 50 copycat cinemas.
I don't know if there would be enough of them.
No, there wouldn't be. We'd have to really stretch to make the comparison.
And I don't know. I listen to a lot of podcasts, fortunately or unfortunately, but I think my main criticism of some of them is they don't know what they are yet. And I think we're still on our journey there to figure out what we're going to be and what we're going to focus on and what we represent. But we're figuring it out. But the ones that do, that have that figured out, they really get a solid fan base and people enjoy listening to it. And I mean, until now, it's just been I like having a reason to keep up with my good friend Steve. And we get That's to true. Talk every other week and hang out and talk about nerdy stuff and hope
and I get to listen to our podcast with my wife and listen to her laugh and know that maybe we are actually funny
occasionally.
Sometimes, I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't be as knowledgeable about nerdy stuff if I didn't have this podcast, cause it made me, you know, research things and keep up with the stuff that's going on in the world and the nerdy areas anyway. But
that's true.
I don't know. It's fun. We want to keep it fun. I'd like to be able to grow Play on Nerds as a whole and have other podcasts, but always just keep this one pretty much me and Steve goofing around
as the staple.
Yeah. And like, if you don't like this podcast, that'll be fine. But this will be like the core where we're just kind of goofing around and we'll have other podcasts that do reviews of shows and other people doing those. But this will be the goofy thing that won't really change too much, but we're going to refine it over time.
And the one constant that I will promise our listeners right now is I will always say awful things. I'm putting that, I'm stamping that with a seal.
He will be always, negative and
I will always be the voice of reason because ghosts aren't real.
Mm-hmm.
And Bigfoot might be real, but I don't think any of the footage anyone has ever shown is Bigfoot.
What's the one show topic you think you'd want to do that we haven't got a chance to do, or you think might just be too risque that you'd want to put out there, if there is one?
There is. And I was thinking about this because we went to high school with somebody named Brandy. I won't say any more than that.
Okay.
Who I was in French class with. And I remember the day she told me that she just didn't believe in dinosaurs.
Oh, goodness.
And I remember saying, well, what do you mean you don't believe? Well, I don't believe they existed. And I said, well, what about the bones? And she launched into this tirade about how God put the bones in the ground to test us.
Mm-hmm.
And it's our fate. And I was like, that doesn't make any sense. Why would God want to do that? And so ever since, I thought that it would be interesting for us to do an episode on how creationists explain science away.
I think we should do a little behind the scenes here. Steve and I had one of our only fights in the past 10 years, probably, over how much conversation we should have on the podcast about our personal beliefs as far as politics, religion. And I was of the mind we should keep it down if we can. He was of the mind we should speak our minds. And we kind of met somewhere in the middle.
Yeah, we did.
Which is great. That's how we stay friends for 20 years. Yeah, but, legit. But I would be totally cool with doing like a podcast where we say, put like a warning ahead of it and say, look, this episode, we're letting it all out. We're going to express our full opinions. If you're going to be offended by any of this, totally fine. Skip this one. Go to the next one. We'll be more lighthearted again. Because as of recently, I've gotten even more passionate about my beliefs as far as my, I am an agnostic atheist, as it's called. And I don't mind.
Wait. Before those two terms were separate to me, how are they now kissing?
I've recently found out that they are, in fact, it's an agnostic is a type of atheist, which I was not aware of. But if you look at the language, apparently atheist means kind of like not gods or lack of belief in gods.
Yeah.
So I don't have an active belief in God or gods. Therefore, I'm an atheist. But the kind of atheist I am is that I leave it up to question. I'm like, I don't know the answers. Maybe there is. Maybe there isn't.
Yeah.
But since I don't have an active belief, I'm still an atheist. I'm an agnostic.
That's how I would classify myself, too.
Yeah.
But, you know, if tomorrow someone scientifically proved that God exists, I go, all right. You got me. All right. God's real.
Yeah. Or if I saw an angel come down and come before me, I'd either think I wouldn't want to think I was crazy. So I'd be like, well, I'm going to believe in God now.
Yeah.
I might do that.
Oh, well, they were right. Okay, cool. We would move on.
Yep. I'd move on. But as saying that, that's why I wanted to be careful with Steve. We talked about that. Just matter of, I don't want to offend anybody who does have a belief in God. So I'm not against you if you have that belief, but Steve and I have strong feelings about that, so we might throw a couple episodes out with that kind of disclaimer. That'd be like, today we're letting it all hang out. We're gonna talk politics, we're gonna talk religion,
because as somebody who used to be a very, I'll say, not say staunch Christian, but I was really up God's butt until about 20. That you can be a Christian and live in the real world where science and the findings and the development of man have been going on. You can live in both of those worlds.
It's possible.
That's the one topic that I thought would be very interesting, and we could get science-y on it. And
yeah, that's the thing, too, is that we can relate it back to being nerds, because you have to do a lot of research. You have to show historical records. You have to be knowledgeable about that stuff, and that's pretty nerdy. So
yeah,
I'd be up for it.
Okay, cool. Well, we'll discuss it.
And we can get some, I'd love to get some more guests on. That's my thing. I think if I want something more on the show in the next year, the next 50 episodes, is maybe get some more academics on, some scientists to study topics. Like, I loved our episode with Ian, who is involved in NASA, JPL. And also we had a professor on who studies women's topics and literature and everything and video games as an academic, which is pretty cool. So if we could get a creationist, a educational creationist and a scientist on, that'd be great.
Yeah.
We could moderate a debate between the two of them.
I'll see if Brandy's available.
Oh God. Hey, remember me? So yeah, it's been fun. Let us know what you guys think. What segments, we really would love to know what segments you really, really like and which segments are kind of boring to you, and we'll kind of move on from there too. That'd be great. So another segment that we love a lot, and that's only Steve has done so far, but it's been a staple of the last 50 episodes, is 5-Minute Aficionado, where Steve informs us. Well, you tell. What exactly is it all about?
I take 5 minutes to tell you a few headlines of how to deal with situations that I have found myself in and didn't know how to handle. What did I do? I did cigars, and I did choosing a wine at a fancy restaurant.
I got a massage.
Yeah. How do you behave at a massage when you've never done it before? But yeah, it's been a lot of fun, but I have passed the torch on to Jarman and told Jarman I wanted him to do one.
Absolutely. And
I'm excited that he did.
And we actually recorded this a couple weeks ago. We weren't able to fit it in the episode, but it fits in anywhere. So we're going to put it in right here for your listening pleasure. And basically me saying how to be an aficionado on wearing a suit properly, like a real man,
like a gentleman. I'm so excited. I encouraged Jarman to do this not that long ago, just a few days ago, and you already put it together. I'm so stoked.
I'm not going to be as good or as smooth or as planned out as Steve is with this because he's, you know, it's his thing. He's mastered it. But there is something that I hold close to my heart that I want more people to be better at, more men in particular, which is wearing a suit.
Ooh.
Now,
okay.
If you go to any event, like a wedding or even a funeral or a dress-up party, you'll see there's always a couple guys there who just look like they've never worn a suit before, or they look disheveled, and it's just so disappointing, and it goes a long way to making you look out of place, unprofessional, unclassy, to be honest. And it's okay if you don't wear a suit any day of the week, any day of the year, because people will think of you that way. But once you go to a special event, you want to look your best. And you don't want to be, oh, obviously he doesn't know how to wear a suit. So just a few little tips, little tiny things you can do to make yourself just look that extra bit of sharpness that maybe will make you stand out. And you can look like any kind of person, any shape or size, and you'll look fantastic in a suit if you just do these small little things.
Okay. I'm excited. Tell me how to not look like a schlub.
Exactly. First of all is make sure it's dry cleaned. So if you have a brand new suit, even if it's brand new, get it dry cleaned professionally because they will make it, you know, look sharp for the first time and put the correct presses into it. Because once you get a new suit, it's going to have all these weird markings on it from the hangers and stuff. You don't want that. So once it's freshly dry cleaned, put the pants on, make sure it's properly hemmed. The pants can't be dragging underneath your feet. They can't be so short that you can see your socks. You want to just break above the shoe. So basically, is that long? It's about $10, maybe $20 to get it hemmed, because it's a really simple thing. If you have a friend who can sew well, they can probably hem something. It's one of the simplest things to do for sewing.
And a lot of times, I know when you go to like a suit store, they'll have someone offer to fit it for you for an additional $20, right?
Yeah, typically. If it's a nicer place, I mean, not even that nice of a place.
Like
typically,
Men's Warehouse.
Yeah, they'll actually, you know, make the whole thing tailored to you pretty much. Not like a professional, you know, tailored suit, but they'll tailor it as best they can to you. So make sure you have that done.
Right.
Because you don't want a loose, ill-fitting suit that's just is flowing everywhere. It's like it's your dad's suit or something. So
yeah, this isn't the 70s.
That's right. Don't do that crap. Also, sleeve length. You know, make sure they make the sleeve proper length. If it looks too short, it looks like you're wearing a suit that you wore when you were a kid. If it's too long, it's your dad's suit again. It looks ridiculous.
Right.
So if you've already worn the suit or if it's sitting in your closet for a while, make sure you get a lint roller out, because as soon as you go out into the sunlight, you may not be able to see it in your room. But if you go out in the sunlight, you're going to have lint all over you because that fabric just collects it. And that little extra bit of lint rolling will make you stand out from the guy next to you who's like he's been rolling around with his dog for 3 days.
Right. Which I have been.
Of course you have. So also make sure your collar is correct. That's a simple check with another person. Just ask them, is my collar okay? If you're wearing a tie with your suit, make sure it's decide ahead of time whether you're going to have the tie all the way up, you know, and correctly fitted to your neck. Don't let it be loose. If you're going to go for the look where you have one button open and have the tie down a little bit, that's okay. Just make sure you own it. Do one or the other. Don't let it just slowly.
You have to have a douchey hairdo to go with it. Don't forget.
If you're wearing a proper dress shirt, if it's a French cuff, that means it'll have little holes and the cuffs will come together. Those will also have buttons, but you shouldn't use those buttons. They're supposed to have cufflinks with those shirts. So keep that in mind.
Are you a fan of the two button or three button?
That's not the thing I was going to go into, actually.
Okay, good.
Fine. Thanks for bringing it up. The three button was in style about, I think, 10 years ago, and two button is now back in style. It doesn't really matter, but something my British uncle told me, which is always a good rule, if it's a three button suit and you're standing up, the rule for which buttons you button is always, sometimes, never.
Yep, I've heard that.
So always button the top one. You can button the second one if it's not squeezing your gut too much, and never button the bottom one. And for a two button suit, it's just always, never. So there you go. And like you'll see this, you'll see celebrities do this all the time. As soon as you stand up from a chair, you button your suit jacket. When you're sitting down, you unbutton it so it doesn't pull on.
Yeah, don't forget to unbutton, because then you're like that fat guy in the suit.
Yeah, and it just, if you do that, everyone will know this guy. Oh, he knows how to wear a suit. Nice, classy. You know, that's how that works. So, and see, these are all small little things you can do, but they all help towards making you look like you know what you're doing.
Yeah.
Wear appropriate socks, appropriate shoes. That's a different kind of story, but about matching clothes. I'm not going to go there for this discussion, but these are simple.
My understanding has always been you match your belt with your shoes.
True. Don't mix brown and black if you can help it, unless it's a very purposeful statement.
And if you can, and if you're not doing black socks, make sure your socks match like your tie.
Yeah. Or if you can be really bold and be wear like bright red socks that don't match anything, but
that's true.
Make it a choice and own it. Don't just do it by accident.
Right. Because if you do red socks and red pocket square, that's fly as shit.
That's pretty cool. Pretty sweet. Right.
Some P. Diddy level stuff.
So that's it. That's my simple little things. And they're common sense, but people just they don't think about it. And it makes a huge difference.
Well, thank you for a 5-minute aficionado. That was exciting.
Thanks so much.
Hear from someone else.
Absolutely. We'll do it again sometime.
Yeah. We'll find more things that we are disgusted by when people do that.
I'm sure there's plenty of those things.
Yes. All right, ladies and gentlemen, now it is time for our patented rating system and trailer reviews. Here to Play On Nerds, we have developed an interesting rating system to bring to you our ideas on the trailers we're about to review. At the low, low end of the scale, we have Burn It, where we think you should find every copy you can get your hands on and throw it into a barrel fire.
Kill it with fire. And our next step is Drunk Watch, which means that, yeah, I'd watch this movie. It'd be entertaining if I was under the influence of some kind of substance of some kind. But if I was sober, probably not going to check this thing out.
Nope, not going to see it. Next, we've got We'll See, which is maybe we just don't know enough about this movie to tell what the hell it's going to be.
Could be good, could be bad, not sure.
Eh.
And our next category would be Get the Couch Ready, which means I'm definitely going to check this movie out at home. Wouldn't necessarily pay the big bucks to see it in theaters, but I'm definitely going to watch it at home, so get that couch ready.
After that, we have Take a Look, where we are recommending for you, our viewers and listeners, to check out this movie and check out the trailer and tell us what you think about it. We wanted to see what you guys think.
It looks pretty good, but we're not quite sure yet.
Yeah, take a look.
Yeah.
Let us know.
And for our final and best category, we have Shut Up and Take My Money.
Shut Up and Take My Money.
This looks so awesome, we're going to see it.
That's where we cannot wait to give Hollywood bigwigs all of the money that we have earned at work to go see a film for $47. We're so excited. We just have to go see it. We don't have a choice.
And that is our A Play on Nerds official copyrighted trademark system for rating our movie trailers.
So we had some interesting ones. Not necessarily fantastic.
Not good, but interesting.
Both of these have been talked about a lot in social media recently for different reasons. What's the first one you want to talk about?
I've got to take Gods of Egypt.
Okay.
They're both so weird, but I got to take Gods of Egypt. So Gods of Egypt appears to be a movie where gods were real and living in Egypt. The Egyptian gods, Anubis and Sol, maybe, I don't know.
Set. Horus.
And two of them battle it out and one of them loses and the god that wins becomes a tyrant. And this young guy has to go on a quest to get the god's eye so that the god can come back and kill the other god.
Yeah.
And Jaime Lannister is in it. I don't understand.
Ages have passed since the gods walked among us. Before the fury swept over our land. For eternity.
You're not fit to be king. It's my turn now.
Set has taken over Egypt and enslaved its people. Only one god can save us, but not without his eyes.
Steal from a god? Only a madman would try such a thing.
Where do you suppose we could find someone so mad?
I have something Set took from you. We need your help.
Soon we will awe the world.
So how do we stop him?
Try to keep up.
You know what's waiting. Set has an army behind him. Gods. Beasts. Demons.
You will bring them reckoning!
Bow before me.
or die. I won't make that mistake.
Is that a storm?
Sets hunters riding their pets.
We should run.
Run?
We mortals do it all the time.
Well, Gerard Butler plays Set, the god Set, and then Jamie Lannister, I can't remember his, he has a really unusual like Nordic name. He plays Horus, the god Horus. And it's kind of cool because they have CGI to make the gods look bigger than the humans. They're like 9 feet tall. It's kind of neat.
Yeah.
But it, everyone's complaining on all over social media because it's another whitewashed Middle Eastern biblical epic where everyone, all the main people are played by white dudes for some reason.
Yeah.
So that's a fair thing.
I don't know. I think it looked bad.
Yeah, it looks cheesy. Too much CGI.
Too much CGI. It might not be a final treatment. Keep that in mind.
True.
I like people that are in it, but so much of this movie just screams that it's going to be like six other movies just and making them all kiss.
Clash of the Titans, all that stuff.
Yeah, it looks like an amalgamation of sort of a genre, and it's going to be the baby of that genre.
Because I think it looks like a fun popcorn spectacle, you know, like a lot of action and crazy stuff going on and cheesy lines, you know. So it could be fun.
Yeah.
But very silly. I would not take it seriously.
No, not. So I'm not going to give this a burn it. I'm going to give this a drunk watch.
You know what? Yeah, I think drunk watch is appropriate.
I can see sitting and going like, oh, let's watch this 2-hour thing where gods are going to kill each other. It's going to be great.
And monsters explode for some reason.
Yeah, just for no reason, just exploding monsters. But yeah, drunk watch, definitely.
I'm changing my head. I had take a look, but the more I think about it, yeah, drunk watch. That'd be great.
Yeah, we don't need our viewers to take a look at this. If they happen to, that's fine, but we don't need you to.
Catch it on Netflix later on when you're having a late night.
So what's our next movie?
Our next movie is Zoolander 2, the sequel that no one asked for, but maybe could be all right.
Or Toolander, depending on how it's spelled on posters.
True. It's like fanforstic.
Yeah.
He was once the world's most famous male model. Even his looks were household names. La Tigra, Magnum, and of course, Blue Steel. But that was a long, long, long time ago.
Old LeMay?
We were a joke out there.
I guess fashion's changed.
Meet the biggest supermodel in the whole world. Is all.
Are you like a male model or a female model?
All is all.
I think he's asking, do you have a hot dog or a bun?
Oops.
Derek Zoolander, I'm with Interpol. I need your help.
She's hot. I trust her.
Someone's trying to kill the world's most beautiful people.
Oh, fudge! Peace out, world.
All of them died with your signature look. This is Blue Steel, right? We need you to infiltrate the world of high fashion.
We're back!
Yeah!
Are you sure Zoolander is the right man to help us?
Hey, handsome!
What the hell is your problem?
God help us all. You were amazing.
I'm sorry, I can't understand a word that you're saying.
Derek, toss me the knife.
You got it!
There's only one criminal mastermind who could be behind all this.
Prison changed me! I am bad to the core now! Talk! Where's my goddamn latte?
But how am I supposed to stop Mugatu?
I'm the Mamba Pajamba! I'm the Mamba Pajamba!
You're Derek Zoolander. You stopped a Chinese throwing star with a look. Flash me that beautiful Magnum.
Wait, Magnum, now! Oh! You have this! Oh. Yeah. Tequila!
Oh! Maybe we could try a washcloth.
I was kind of, I'm kind of intrigued. It looks kind of like a return to like the goofy ass comedies that we all loved in the 90s and the 2000s that had Ben Stiller and Owen Wilson in them. But none of the dialogue looks awful. Like it looks like it's supposed to be ridiculous on purpose like the old one was. So I'm not turned off completely. I don't know. What do you think?
So I think the sequels I love best are the ones that know that they're sequels and poke fun at the original content. That's one thing. That's why I love Gremlins 2.
Yeah.
If it's not my favorite movie, it's my favorite sequel ever. Because they know that, that Gremlins was a little bit ridiculous. They man up to it and then they just go with it. I think that this movie, they've shown some of the same of that in this preview, that they're poking back at the original film. But when you're poking back at a film that was so insanely ridiculous initially, it could really go over the top. This whole movie could just be insane to the point where it's not funny.
Like too much overload.
Too much. Yes. And that's where I fear they're going.
Yeah, it's possible. I mean, you're right though, that they are kind of making fun of themselves. Like they,
which is good.
They call themselves old and the other guy's a tag on and he says, LeMay?
LeMay?
It spells lame, but yeah. Will Ferrell returns as the villain, Mugatu. Mm. And we have, what's her name? Penelope Cruz as like the sexy chick who helps them out, I guess. And Kristen Wiig's character, I think, might be the funniest thing in there.
Yeah, I love Kristen Wiig.
Kristen Wiig's like in this horrible, like old age slash too much plastic surgery makeup. It looks really funny.
If there is nothing else in the theaters and my wife and I need a date night, we may go see this movie. But otherwise, I'll give it a we'll see.
I give it get the couch ready because I'm going to watch this at some point. I'm going to want to. So, but I would not probably pay to see it in theaters.
I just can't tell how it's going to be yet. The next preview that they release might completely change my mind.
True. Did I tell you I saw Kristen Wiig once in a bar?
What? Did you touch her?
No. We were in a bar in Atlanta because they're constantly filming movies in Atlanta. And she was there with a bigger people, like her family probably, because a lot of older people there with her. And she was playing darts with her family. And I was like, I really would wish I had something to say to her, but I don't. And I don't want to just walk up there and annoy her for no reason.
You're a famous lady.
I appreciate you.
You make me giggle.
So I just stared at her for a little while from afar and just wished I could have said something or done something or taken a picture. But I didn't want to be a jerk like most people are. So I just let her go and just will remember that in my head for the rest of my life.
Oh, yeah. I've got the same. I was in New York for maybe my 23rd birthday with my brother, and we had done something early in the day. And he goes, let's go to this bar for a drink. And I said, why? We're going out later. He goes, let's just go to this bar for a drink. Place called The Magician. It was like 2 or 3 o'clock on a Saturday. So before the bar crowds hit.
Yeah.
And he goes, well, let's just see. I heard a rumor about this place. And so we go and we sit down. And sure enough, at a table in the corner is Mike Myers.
Huh. One of your favorites.
Some of his friends. Oh my God. I flipped the fuck out. apparently they play like street hockey, like rollerblade hockey in a caged in park close on Saturday afternoons.
Oh wow.
And then they go to this bar and it's like a ritual they have. And sure enough, there he was. And at one point he was within arm's distance.
Wow. And was there like a crowd back, there with him?
He was in a booth with like 3 or 4 other people.
Wow. Was the bar not very busy?
No, there was like no one there.
It was a well-kept secret.
Yeah. But I remember, I kick myself now because it was my birthday.
Oh.
And if there was a day I could have asked him for like a picture or an autograph, it would be like, hey, it's my birthday, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. And I look back now and I'm like, why the fuck didn't you do that? Oh, that's right. You were respecting a celebrity's privacy and treating them like a human.
I know. It's like we're the nice guys who actually do that. But
right.
Like, rarely do people actually respect privacy.
I was just happy to be in his presence.
Yeah. And you can remember that forever now.
Yeah. Forever.
In your mind bullets.
And cry at night.
Thank you for being a friend. Travel.
So now we're going to move on to our thank you section, which we didn't get to do last week, or last show, rather. First and foremost, a very important email we received from a certain person's wife.
Somebody. I don't know who.
From Anna Marie, Steve's wife. She wrote about, I'm trying to remember what this was in reference to. Oh, villains episode. Right.
Villains episode.
So Anna says, what up? Love the villains episode, though I must say I was a little sad there was no mention of Bob from Twin Peaks. His ability to manipulate people is truly terrifying. Although, spoilers ahead, if you don't watch Twin Peaks, stop reading now or stop listening now.
Spoilers! Spoilers! Spoilers!
Since he is a demon and not actually a person, I can see why he was left off the list. Because, you know, ghosts and demons are things, and things aren't real. Keep up the good work.
And in honor of my wife, who there is a very small thing we do on the show that she just hates. And that's the spoilers sound effect.
And it's going to be played right there when I say that.
Right. Anna made the mistake of using the word spoilers in her email.
She did.
And now she's going to pay for it.
That's hilarious. And she also was awesome and wrote Fire Walk With Me at a play on nerds.com. That's what she emailed that to.
Ah, very nice.
That's the name of the movie for Twin Peaks. So she's smart and she's funny and she's cute. Well done.
Yeah.
Also on our Facebook page, in reference to our last episode where we did a lot of wild speculation about the next Trek series, we had our lovely guests Ryan and Chris on there for that. Sean Vanderloo, who has his own podcast, Sci-Fi Waffle, where they did a big speculation podcast too. Uh-huh. He says, Captain the Rock, Michael Chiklis as counselor, Packleds? Yes, please. I'm thinking a renegade Starfleet ship called USS Hades. I'd love The Rock as the captain, Michael Chiklis as counselor. But that's a great name for the ship too, USS Hades. And this is from Daniel Hitch, our wonderful longtime listener. He says, listen to this episode, Stacking Shelves at the Supermarket where I work nights. I got some funny looks from my colleagues when I openly laughed at Ron Perlman as a Packled. I posted a pitch for my dream Trek universe on the TrekMate website. I think as CBS will have a network, they'll be missing a trick not making a universe like Marvel/DC tied together with crossovers and a shared cast.
Right.
But each show aimed at different demographics, i.e. CW young adult show at the Academy or an old audience political drama in the Federation. President's Office, or a Muppets/Modern Family/The Office type mockumentary set in a backwater security outpost arresting the scum of the galaxy for the YouTube generation. I could see all those things working.
Yeah, that'd be cool.
Maybe even Star Trek Packled, a show for juniors aged 3 to 6 where they teach kids to learn letters and numbers because they are not smart. They are not strong. Those are Packleds or aliens are really dumb in Star Trek, Steve, just in case.
Okay. Yeah. Nothing.
So his dream cast includes James McAvoy as the captain, because he's already a certified Trekker, and with him playing captain, will come full circle with his following Patrick Stewart through nerddom. I agree with that. He already played Patrick Stewart in X-Men. He could do it again in Star Trek.
Possibly.
Well, thanks for that, Daniel Hitch, and for Sean. I appreciate that. And Anna Marie, thanks for writing in.
So now, since it is the 50th, I would like to do sort of a wider thank you.
Oh.
So first off, I want to thank Jarman's parents, who have been very supportive of the podcast. Karen and Scott, thank you.
Sure, they'll appreciate that.
I'm not sure if you actually listen to this, but we appreciate it. We truly do. Thank you for believing in our dreams.
Absolutely. They've been wonderful. They're executive producers, basically.
to my mom, who listens to every episode and every now and then writes me about how good it was.
Oh, that's wonderful.
So thank you, Mom. And so this is going to be a tough one. I want to give a thank you to Jarman.
Oh,
my co-host, I guess, because though I do write a good chunk of the bits and that sort of thing, Jarman does so much work on the back end to make it sound beautiful. When I forget to record, he figures out how to make it seem like what we end up having to record after actually sounds like it was in the episode. He does a lot of production work and does all the intros and stuff. And he does a ton of work. So Jarman, thank you for taking on that yoke of the podcast. I appreciate it.
Well, you are welcome, sir. And I have to say, even though I do all that work, throughout this past year and a half we've been doing this, if I didn't have Steven also not just doing a lot of the bits and stuff like that and coming up with content for the show, him always saying, I get a message, what are we doing for the show this week, Jarman? What are we doing? And I'm like, fuck, yeah, you're right. Damn it.
Oh, we got to do something.
So if he wasn't there dogging me on this past year and a half, we would have like half the shows we have now. So
quite possibly.
So thank you for that, Steve. You've been wonderful keeping this thing going. I'm just so happy going in. I didn't know if my interest would have stayed around, if your interest was going to stay around. And we both just kept it going in our own ways. So we're both awesome. Look at that.
Yeah, we are. We're great. Internet, listen up.
Yeah, you better start listening, damn it.
Bastards.
I mean, we love you, all of you.
Love
listening
you. Right now. Sorry, Raul Julia.
Sorry. Oh, so that, I think that's a wonderful, lovely end. Thank you, Steve, for that.
Yeah.
Of our 50th anniversary. And thank you to our listeners and the people who stuck around for so long.
All the guests, with Cameron, the Vanderloos, Brian and Chris and
Ian and
so many. Ian. Yes. That lady who came on and told us about sexist stuff.
Kristen Smith. Yep.
Kristen. Yes, that's the one.
And thanks to all the guests we're going to have this coming up 50 episodes.
Yeah, we're excited for it. So this is A Play on Nerd signing off from the 50th episode. It's been a good one. Thanks again, Internet.
Stay nerdy, my friends.